The time is right. There's no need to wait. Your path will be washed by rivers of grace.
Come, Jesus, come. We've been waiting so long.
Return soon. There's a lot of prophecies that's been fulfilled, and he is soon to return. Why wait? Why wait? I don't get it sometimes. I got family that, like Brother Warren says, they're on the fence, but the devil owns that fence. It's either all or nothing. You can't work a little bit at work and expect to get paid. You'll eventually get fired, right? Start slacking off, going to sleep during the work hours, and they won't like that. The Lord don't like a half-giving heart. He wants you to give your all, 100%. He deserves it. He's worthy of it all. Praise the Lord. I love that verse that said to bring it all to him. It doesn't matter what we're going through, how we are. You know, we weren't perfect when we came to him, were we? We were filthy, filthy rags. That's why he's got the salvation, his mercy. It takes time. It is salvation. That's why it's called salvation. Amen. Tangie's preaching, not me, okay? Praise the Lord. Who's glad to be in the house of the Lord? Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. I'll go open up in prayer this evening. Does anybody have an outspoken prayer request? Stressful thing, having dogs run away from you. They know where the food bucket is, hopefully still. Amen. Yeah, well, pray for that. Anybody else? Brother Claude, yeah, we had to reach out and get a hold of them. TJ. We know the one that can heal, right?
Amen.
Amen. Anybody? Why we have that heavenly language. We don't know what we're saying or praying. But praise the Lord, God knows. He knows what needs to be done. Anybody else? Maybe behind me.
I have a praise report.
All right.
Yesterday I went to Manny,
make those crooked paths straight. Praise the Lord. That's good. Anybody else? Remember Tommy. Any more outspoken? Maybe unspoken? Lift up the hands. God knows our needs. If you would, let's stand. We're going to go to prayer. We're going to go into the worship. Let's put into this, you know, to get what the Lord has for us this evening. Jimmy, I would open us up for prayer, buddy.
Thank you, Father God.
Freedom reigns in this place. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Brian, can you turn that off? Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Pastor, for another time to minister God's word. Amen. It's good to be in the house of the Lord tonight. Glory to God. No place that I would rather be than in his house. Amen. Amen. Tonight, we're going to get right into our scriptures. If you can stand to your feet, we're going to go to Joel chapter 2, verse 1. The title of my message is The Day of the Lord is Coming. Blow ye the trumpet in Zion, and sound an alarm in my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord cometh, for it is nigh at hand. Pastor, can you pray? Thank you, Jesus. We praise you tonight, God. We give you glory in this house tonight, God. Yes, Lord Jesus, have your way here tonight, God. We give you praise, God. We give you glory. Yes, Lord Jesus, have your way. Yes, hallelujah, Jesus. Yes, have your way here tonight, God. Yes, Lord Jesus, have your way. Lord, I need you tonight, God. We need you tonight, Lord Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, Lord, we praise you tonight in this house, God. You're worthy, Lord, you're worthy. Hallelujah, Lord. Amen. And you can be seated in the house of the Lord. Amen. How many of you know that the day of the Lord is coming? It is near, it is at hand. Amen. The Old Testament scriptures dealing with the day of the Lord often conveys a sense of immense nearness and expectation. Isaiah 13 and 6 says, "How? For the day of the Lord is at hand. It shall come as a destruction from the Almighty." Ezekiel 30 and 3 says, "For the day is near, even the day of the Lord is near." Joel 2, 1 said, "Let all who live in the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. It is near at hand." Joel 3 and 14 says, "Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision, for the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision." Amen. The Lord is coming. He's coming soon. Amen. And the Lord is warning us tonight. Some of this is a warning to some of us. This is a message of hope that the Lord is coming. But it is coming quickly. It's quicker now. It's closer now than it has ever been before, Sister Paula. I am looking, if you're watching everything that's happening, every time I get up here, I preach it because I feel an urgency. We need to warn people. We need to let people know that Jesus is getting ready to step into those clouds and come back. But more than that, amen, as soon as the rapture takes place, there's going to be a time on this earth like never before that it's going to take place, a time of tribulation, a time of great sorrow, amen. And I don't want to be here when that time takes place. If you've read the back of the book, if you've read chapter Revelation, read through it, we don't have time tonight to go everything that's going to happen, but there's going to be so much pain, so much sorrow, so much suffering. The wicked, the church is going to be removed out of here. And when the church is removed from out of here, there's going to be evil that's going to be let loose on this land like never before. And you don't want to be here to go through that time. I am here sounding the alarm tonight to say, get ready, get ready, get ready. The Old Testament passages referring to the day of the Lord, they often speak of both a near and a far fulfillment, as does much of Old Testament prophecy. Some of the Old Testament passages that refer to the day of the Lord, they describe the historical judgments that have already been fulfilled. And while there's others that there's divine judgments that are still yet to come. There's still that are going to take place towards the end of the age. The New Testament calls it a day of wrath, a day of visitation, and the great day of God Almighty. It refers to a still future fulfillment when God's wrath is poured out on unbelieving Israel and on the unbelieving world. It is coming. I don't believe the church will be here, Crystal. I don't believe those that are truly saved and born again, Cheyenne, those who have made their hearts ready and they're looking. I don't believe, Pastor, that we will be here. But what we're going to have to go through, I cannot tell you that tonight. We're still going to have to go through some things. There's still going to be some trials and some tribulations, some things and some hard times that we're going to face tonight. We're going to go through, and we need to hold on to the Word of God like never before, because it is getting hard. It is getting tough out there right now. We see what's happening. It's fixing to take place in November. We don't know who's going to be our next president. We don't know what's going to happen, and I'm here to tell you, America's not going to be great again. I'm going to make that statement. I know that's hard to hear. We want a man to come in and to save us, but there is only one that's coming back, and his name is Jesus. He is our only Savior tonight. Man is not our Savior tonight. Amen. Donald Trump, I pray for him. I know he's got a hard job, and he is one. Over 4 years, God gave us a reprieve. He gave us a time where this land was doing great. The economy was booming. The prices were down. But now when Biden came back in, I think that God, I know it, because the Bible tells us that God puts in place the authorities. Those are who in the White House, he allows them there. And this is only the beginning of what is going to come. There is a greater evil. And even though there's a time that it's going to look like it's going to get better, it's not. Don't be deceived. Amen. Don't be deceived tonight. Glory to God. Amen. The scriptures indicate that the day of the Lord will come quickly like a thief in the night. It comes unexpectedly. You're not looking for, you're not going to expect. People are not going to be looking. Even to the rapture of the church, people are not going to be looking for God to return. In that day, when there's a time of peace after the church is taken out, they're going to go through and they're not going to be expecting the day of the Lord of what's coming upon this land. But God said it will happen, Sister Janice. It's going to come. And I'm telling you, that to me, if I could scare you tonight, if I could for any way possible tell you, read Revelation. Find out what God says is coming. Sin will not go unpunished tonight. There's a lot of sin. A lot of things that are happening. People are living any way they want to. They're acting any way that they want to. And they're still saying they are a Christian. They come and they say a sinner's prayer. And then they walk out of here and they keep living the same way that they want to live. But I'm here to tell you, you can't keep living like this world, living like the devil, acting like the devil, and still think that you're going to make it to heaven tonight. Amen. Glory to God. I know this is a hard word, but I had tucked this away, but God said, preach it tonight. So tonight I'm bringing the word, and I know there's a lot of y'all are saved, but you've got family members who are not. And God says we need to keep warning them. We need to keep telling them, let them know that Jesus is coming. I want to get inside of you tonight a sense of urgency. I feel it so strong, Sister Nancy, that Jesus is fixing to come back, and people are going to be caught off guard. Amen. 2 Peter 3:10 says, but the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are in it will be burned up. The book of Joel is only three chapters long. It's only got 73 verses. Joel is one of our minor prophets, the son of Pethuel. I'm not sure. That's one of those hard names. But his name means Jehovah is God. How many of you tonight know that Jehovah is God? Amen. He is the one true God. It's not Allah. It's not Buddha. But it's God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. They are three, but yet they are one tonight. Jehovah God. Amen. Glory to God. Little else is known about his background. Many are familiar with Job because of Peter's reference to him on the day of Pentecost, where he identified the outpouring of the Holy Spirit as the fulfillment of the first part of Joel's prophecy in Joel 2:28-32. Now, despite Joel's position as a minor prophet, his message carries a profound significance tonight. Joel's prophecy aligns with all the other prophecies regarding the end time and what is to come. What is to come, not what has happened, not yesterday, but what is coming. Amen. I believe, along with many of the others, that the second part of Joel's prophecy will be fulfilled during the tribulation period and at the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ during the battle of Armageddon and through to the end of the millennium. If you ever have studied any of this, you understand when the rapture and the second coming of the Lord is not the same thing. The Lord's going to step out on his clouds, and we're going to go and we're going to rise and meet him in the air. But when he comes back the second time, it'll be at the very end of the age. Amen. Glory to God. How many of you know that God always warns us before judgment comes? God is warning us tonight. God is warning his people. God is warning the church. The rapture is going to take place. He's warning everybody that's out there through his prophets, through his teachers, through his preachers, through his word. He's always warned and he's always said, before it comes, he always gives you a chance, Crystal, to get it right. Some of you here tonight under the sound of my voice need to hear this tonight. We don't have time, I've said it, to play around. We've got to get it right. We need to check our hearts. We need to be careful how we live our lives, what we listen to, what we're playing on our radios, what we're reading, books that we're reading that we're taking in. You know, our Bible tells us to stay, to flee the very appearance of evil. And yet, you see what happened up there with the Olympics. For me, God convicted me. We're not even to partake in the Olympics, in the watching of the Olympics. I stand against that very strongly tonight because there's a lot of people, they said, well, we didn't take part in the opening part of it where they mocked God. God says, I will not be mocked. How many of them actually stepped down, boycotted, came against what they did, or did they continue on participating because they would win a gold medal? It was wrong. I am a preacher who will stand up here. I don't care how many people come against me. You should not be watching it. You should not be for it. You should not be cheering them on. It's sin. Turn it off. Don't support it. When you know that you know that something is wrong, I know there is so much in this world. My heart is so grieved because it's like you turn on the TV and it's in your face. Everything that you watch, it's in your face. And it's up to you to turn it off. My family knows that if something comes on, I'll turn it off. I'll walk away. I won't keep on watching it. I won't keep on listening to it. And I urge you, if you're truly a true Christian, a born again, you know what God, you know, which if he was standing there, and I believe he's always with us. He's in us. He's with us. He's around us. He's always there watching. Nothing is hidden from his sight. We might think, oh, well, God didn't see this little bit. It's okay. This isn't that bad. Oh, it's just a TV show. Get it out of your life. Be careful. We are at the coming of the Lord. It is not worth it. Be careful, young people. Be careful. Daniela, you're getting ready to go to college. There's going to be a lot of temptations that are set before you. There's going to be a lot of kids that's going to try to pull you into things. You've got to stand firm in your faith. You cannot look to the left or to the right, but you've got to keep on going. And you've got a body of believers right here. We're going to stand with you. We're going to cover you and keep you protected. Amen. That the devil's not going to touch you. God's got a great plan for your life, a great call on your life, and he's going to use you mightily. But you keep on going. When you trust God, he's going to keep you. He's opened this door. I believe with all my heart he's made a way for you, and he's going to keep you as long as you keep your eyes on him. Amen. Give him a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. In the book of Joel, we see that the people of Judah desperately needed a warning sign. They were on the road to destruction. Israel had turned to false gods and forsaken the true God of their ancestors. So Joel would write to them to wake them up, to shake them out of their spiritual slumber. I believe that many today, Pastor, are in a spiritual slumber. Many people, not just, I believe this is not just to our church. Like I said, this is out there on Facebook. This is out there to everyone that will hear tonight. Wake up, wake up, wake up. You got to come out of that place. You can't just live the way you want to. We serve a holy God. We serve a righteous God. He is to be lifted up, to be respected. We need to be careful because the church today has just gone anyway. That you see a lot of the churches, they don't care how they dress. They come like they do when they're in their homes, in their bedrooms. And there's a certain way to come into the presence of God still. I believe that. To dress right. We have to be careful how we come into His presence. Don't mistake all the jumping and the emotions and the lights for His presence. Don't mistake that for God's presence tonight just because it looks good on the outside. Just because it looks like it's God does not mean it's God if it does not line up with His Word. Because I see a lot of that, but I don't see a lot of changed lives. I don't see a lot of, because if it was true, Sister Nancy, we would see a different America today. People's morals, values, living together, just doing whatever they want to do. Getting married today, what is that? We just go, we live together, and we act any way we want to, and it's okay. Church, it's not. Young people, it's not okay to just live together, to be together, to act the way you want to, and think that you're going to be okay. Amen. God is speaking to His church tonight. Amen. God is speaking to us tonight. In chapter 1 and 2, Joel says, "Hear this, ye old man, and give ear, all ye inhabitants of the land." Joel asked the people, "Have you ever witnessed anything like this before?" And then he says, "Tell your children, and let them tell their children, and their children another generation." In other words, let your children know that sin will not go unpunished. According to verse 4, at the time this prophecy was given by God to Joel, it seems that Judah was utterly devastated and ruined by a plague of locusts. In the scriptures, we see that locusts are a divine means used by God to get the attention of His people when they rebel and persist on sinning. God has sent things on this land. God has allowed things to happen to get our attention. We don't call it like they used to. Back in the Bible days, they would call it for what it is. It was something that was sent by God. God's people here, this had come on God's people, not like back when Pharaoh, when the locusts came on the people of Egypt. But this time, it was on God's people. Their crops, their cattle, all of that, the locusts had eaten it all and taken it all away. And God used this to wake them up, to try to get a hold of them. In God's mercy and grace, God is trying to get a hold of us tonight. He's trying to get a hold of His church. He's trying to get a hold of the people in this land and say, wake up. You would think this house would be packed out of what we've been through with this presidency, what we see that's coming in this land after COVID, after the church was almost shut down, that people have gone back to sleep. They've gone back about their lives. They're living any way they want to. They're doing just like in the days of Noah. They're drinking, they're eating, and they're marrying. They're going about their lives living just like they want to, and they're not heeding the warning. We have to be careful. Note that God will only permit a people to go so far into their sinning before punishing their sins. Judgment day will certainly come. This is what we see happening. Divine judgments were about to be inflicted upon the land, which would have their climax in the dread day of the Lord. Verse 6 talks about a nation coming against the land. This refers to the soon-to-come Babylonian invasion of Judah that took place. Now, the second part of this verse says, "And he has the cheek teeth of a great lion." This refers to the coming Antichrist who will come from Syria and Babylon. This was occurred according to the commentary that I've read. I read a lot of commentary in trying to study this. I was like, Lord, I'm not sure that I understand or comprehend all of it, but I understand that this is both the day of the Lord was for then, and there's also a great coming day of the Lord. Amen. This was all because of their sins. Judgment is coming. If He would punish them back then in such a way, even to the very end, God's wrath being poured out, even during the tribulation time, is His mercy and His grace. Because you don't want even your worst enemy to suffer the judgment that's coming, the ultimate judgment at the end of this age. You don't want to go to hell, but that really, that's a temporary place. Did you know that? Because hell and death will both be swallowed up and thrown into the lake of a fire, the lake of fire that's at the end of the age, that all the wicked will be thrown into. The devil, the false prophet, the Antichrist, all of those will be thrown to at the very end of the age. But if you won't serve God now, sir, ma'am, young people, if y'all won't serve him now, I bet, I think, it'll be so much harder to say that you'll serve him then. Because the deception is so great right now, there's coming a greater deception across this land, that when the Antichrist comes, they will think he's God. You'll see somebody that's going to be put in place that will be able to provide for the first 3.5 years of the tribulation. They will provide. He will be able to provide. He'll have peace. Everything will look good. There will be great miracles. He'll set himself up as God until he breaks that peace treaty in that second part, the last 3.5 years. And then at that time, you're going to be required to take the mark of the beast. I know a lot of people, they're putting everything out there. You see, they're getting it ready. They're getting people used to the idea. In the hand, you can get, it's like a piece of rice in your hand even now. And people are already scanning with it. They're already putting it in there in some places. Is that the mark? No, I believe it's coming after the church is gone. I believe, and it's going to be in such a way that people will just take it. They'll be so used to it. You get somebody that's starving, somebody that's hungry, needs to get around, gas, food, they'll do whatever they got to do because people love their life more than they love God, especially during this time. Judgment is coming. Joel says to the priest in verse 13, cry out to God, weep before the altar, lay in sackcloth all night, call a fast and gather all the elders and the people of the land into the house of the Lord your God and cry unto the Lord. We need to get back to the altars. We need to get back in these altars. When Pastor gives an altar call, when I give an altar call, when Stephanie, when one of these ministers, I would be running to these altars. Don't wait for the altar call. Get up. Don't wait for it to be the right altar call. Well, he didn't say this or he didn't give this reason for you to. The only reason is just because you've got another chance to get before God. You got another chance to say, God, I need you tonight. God, I can't do this without you. We've got to get back to the altars. We need to get back to the altars. Step by step, the Holy Spirit through the prophet Joel tells Judah what that she must do, which if done would avoid destruction. But sadly, it was to no avail. It was to no avail. Amen. There are those, the true ministers of the gospel, who are warning people that judgment is coming, but few are heeding this warning, continuing on living their lives just like in the days of Noah. Joel goes on to say, alas for the day of the Lord is at hand, and as a destruction from the Almighty shall it come. The day of the Lord is a time when God judges sinners, restores the earth, and brings glory to himself. It's all connected to Jesus' second coming. God's people often anticipated the day of the Lord as a time when their enemies would be punished and they would be liberated. But God wanted them to understand that the day of the Lord had come because of their transgressions, not their enemies. Judgment had been sent to get their attention and to get them to repent and return. Repent and return. Repentance needs to be preached more often. Repent from your sins. Turn from your wicked ways. Call on the name the Lord. None of us are good. There was only one that was good, and his name is Jesus. We all fall short, Sister Crystal, every single day. We need Jesus. The closer you get to God, the more you see your need for Jesus. Because you know this flesh is sinful. In the presence of a holy God, the closer you get to Him, the more you realize that you wouldn't be able to live in His presence if it wasn't for Jesus. Oh, how we need Jesus. People need the Lord. In Joel chapter 2, Joel gives us a call to alarm. He says, blow ye the trumpet in Zion and sound an alarm in my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord comes, for it is near at hand. Israel and Jerusalem are the place where these future events will happen. The phrase, let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, refers to Israel, where the battle of Armageddon will take place. For the day of the Lord comes, for it is near at hand, refers to the period in the future when the Messiah will interfere on behalf of his ancient people and deliver and restore them. Its details are predicted in the book of Revelation. Read the book of Revelation. Don't run from it. Don't let it scare you. Read it. Even if you don't understand, there's so much commentary out there. If you want to understand, pray for understanding. Amen. And if you can't understand it, get under somebody that can teach it to you. There's a lot of good teachings out there on the book of Revelation. You need to see and know what's coming upon this land, Sister Judy. It is fixing to happen. Just like when Jesus said he was coming, he came, and they were not looking. He's coming again. Are you looking tonight? Are you looking for him, TJ? Are you expecting his return? Do you believe it tonight? He is coming. Don't be caught off guard. This preacher is here telling you tonight, he is coming. Amen. Preachers, teachers, leaders everywhere must sound an alarm at the condition of the modern church, for these events that Joel speaks about are near at hand. This also means that the rapture of the church, which will precede these events, is near, very, very near. I don't know about y'all, but that excites me. My heart is grieved. Living in this world of sin that surrounds us, you can't do anything. You can't hardly go anywhere without seeing, hearing the words of people taking the Lord's name in vain. Sister Paula, you work in Walmart and you know what comes through there. And you can't hide from it. You can't run from it. You have to be grieved in your spirit. If you truly know the Lord Jesus Christ and you know His Word, you have to look at people and see them and pray for them. If that doesn't grieve you, when you look at them and you hear what's coming out of people, you see what they're doing and all of this sin and the stuff that's going on. If it doesn't grieve your heart, something is wrong with you. How can you be happy living in this world anymore with what we see that's going on? We are still supposed to live. We're still supposed to carry on. We're still supposed to be about the Father's business. I do understand that. But it says, set your affections on things above and not on things below. Amen. Amen. Glory to God. If this election and everything that's been happening here lately wasn't going on, it wasn't like it used to be. If you look back just 10 years ago and where we are today, It's just getting worse, and it's coming faster and faster. It's speeding up with everything. It's like every time you open up the newspaper, you see something else. You see somebody who's killed somebody, a child who's killed a father or a mother. You see all this wickedness and this evil. For what? The domestic violence that's out there today, the drugs, the alcohol. There's so much that's out there. People are so deceived, and they're turning to the things of this world to find something to fill the hole that we have. We have Jesus. This is what they need. This is who they need tonight. They don't need another drug, because a drug won't do it tonight. Alcohol won't do it tonight. A boyfriend, a girlfriend. Young people, I say, find somebody who is so lost in God that they got to find God before they can be with you tonight. Find somebody that will lead you to the altars. Find somebody that will take you by the hand and get you to God tonight. Be careful who you make your life with. Be careful, because so many people are unequally yoked today. So many people are just marrying anybody, living with anybody. It doesn't matter. And that's why we have what we have today. Homes are broken today, because you're not really praying and seeking God for who you should be with. And I am. I'm talking to the young people, because I see you tonight. God sees you tonight. He sees every one of you. He knows every one of you by name. And He's got a great plan for your life tonight. But you've got to want what He wants for you. You've got to be careful. There's a wide road that leads to destruction tonight. But there's a narrow path that leads to life tonight. But you have to make the choice on what you want. Are you going to follow your friends and go out there and go to a devil's hell just because you're popular, or because it's what everybody else is doing tonight? Or is that what we're going to do tonight? We can't do it just because the world's doing, because it sounds good, because it looks good. We can't do it just because they say it's okay tonight. We have to change. We have to be different. The Word of God says, come out and be ye separate tonight. Don't go and live as they live and think you're going to be okay. Oh, hallelujah. Glory to God. Joel goes on to describe the armies of God at Armageddon in verses 2 through 10. In 2:11, Joel says, "And the Lord shall utter His voice before His army, for His camp is very great, for He is strong who executes His word. For the day of the Lord is great and very terrible, and who can abide it?" We're going to be part of that camp, the bride of Christ. The church today, the angels and the saints of God, they're going to return with Him, and it will be exceedingly great. Who can abide and or endure it? This is the word to Israel. Only the Lord God Almighty has the power to back up His word. All the predictions that are spoken by the prophet Joel, they shall come to pass exactly as stated. All of this speaks of the second coming of Christ. The Lord calls for repentance and fasting from His people. He urges His people to return to Him with all of their hearts, demonstrating genuine repentance through fasting, weeping, and mourning. Through fasting, weeping, and mourning. Just because we're not doing a fast, a corporate fast, doesn't mean stop fasting. I feel the Lord, and I told Pastor this morning, even he told me he still feels an urgency to continue to fast, even if it's not corporately. Do it on your own, because there's devils out there that will only come out through fasting and prayer. Through fasting and prayer. We need a church that's on its knees fasting and praying, not because of a minister told you to fast or to pray, because you got a hold of God. You were in your secret place and God says, I need you to fast. Because people are dying and going to hell every single day. Our families are destroyed because we're not praying and seeking God the way we should. I know, I told the Lord this week, Pastor, I'm tired. It is hard. It really is, but we got to do it if we want to see God's people coming in. If we want to see the lost coming and filling up this church. Amen. There's a whole community out there that needs Jesus. We're that light on the hill. Well, I guess we're not on a hill, but we're on this piece of land, this little corner right here. We're that light. Why did God put the Elgin CH Church here? It wasn't just so we could have a pretty building tonight. It was so that we could be a light to this community. We, as the body of Christ, have to get out of these walls and say, Jesus is coming. Jesus is coming. Amen. The Lord calls for repentance. Amen. We also see that God's compassion and willingness to forgive those who turn to Him sincerely. He promises restoration and blessings for those who heed the call, pledging to intervene on behalf of His people against their enemies and to provide abundant blessings, including grain, wine, and oil. None of this is because it's deserved, but it's because God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him, Vanessa, would not perish but have everlasting life. Amen. Although this was given to Israel, it is a call that is given to us today as well. Repent and turn from your sins. Rend your heart, not your garments. This was tradition. This was what was told the Jews. They would tear their garments as a sign of remorse and repentance. But this isn't what God wants. This isn't what God requires of us. This was an outward show that back then they would tear their garments. They would say, okay, we're going to repent. And this was how they would. God said, no, I don't want you to do that, because you see, God sees our heart tonight. Do you know that? God sees everything that you do in secret. I might not can see it, but God can, and He knows your heart. He says, tear your hearts, rend your hearts. Amen. We got to get back. It's not just about a prayer, a simple prayer. Jesus, forgive me of my sins and keep on going. You have to truly mean it tonight. God wants a people who truly repent and mean what they say and say what they mean tonight. Joel says that our God, He is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness. Now we see the promise of the Holy Spirit was in Joel 2 and 28 and 32. Is first there must be repentance, a turning away from sin, and then you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. The only thing that must take place before you receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost is that you're saved. Then you could call on the name. Verse 32 says, all who call on the name will be saved. You need the baptism of the Holy Ghost. The great outpouring that was predicted by Joel began on the day of Pentecost. The Lord told the disciples when He would go away, He said, go and tarry and wait before you go out to minister, because you're going to need the Holy Ghost to be able to overcome. It's not just about power to go out there to lay hands on the sick, to heal the sick, but it's so that you can overcome sin. This flesh is very powerful. The devil, he's very powerful. And without the Holy Ghost, it's very hard. I do believe the Holy Spirit comes in us the day that we accept the Lord Jesus as our Savior. Because even the thief on the cross, Jesus looked at him and said, today you'll be with me in paradise. But He told the disciples, go and tarry, for you need this dunamis power. You need this power to be able to live in this world. Things are going to get worse. And if you're not careful, if you're not rooted and grounded, filled up with the Holy Ghost, it is free. All you have to do is ask Him and keep asking Him. Don't give up until you're filled up. I'm going to say it again. Don't give up till you're filled up. Baptized, speaking with other tongues that you know. And don't just get one time. Continue to seek Him day in and day out, because you need the power. When you don't know how to pray, you pray in the Holy Ghost. because he knows the heart of the Father. He knows what needs to be prayed. You find yourself in situations, Sister Heidi, and you don't know what to do, pray in the Holy Ghost. He'll pray. The Holy Ghost, when you pray, it brings edification to you. To you, the believer, builds you up, gives you strength to be able to carry on, to be able to go through situations like Sister Diane and Brother David did, like they've been going through. Without the Holy Ghost, how would you have made it? Without the Lord Jesus Christ, how could you be sitting back there tonight? Sister Johnny, you understand what I'm talking about. You've been through some things. How could you go through what you've been through without him? We need the Holy Ghost. Amen. In Joel chapter 3, the prophet foretells of the future judgment of the nations and the ultimate vindication of God's people. The chapter begins with the destruction of God's judgment against the nations that mistreated Israel, particularly focusing on the Valley of Jehoshaphat. The Lord promises to gather all of the nations for judgment, separating the righteous from the wicked. Matthew 25 and 32, this is where the nations, they shall be gathered before the Lord, and he's going to separate them. Just like a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats, so will he. The text emphasizes that God will bring retribution upon those who harmed his people. Following this, Joel portrays a sense of divine intervention, with God gathering his people and restoring their fortunes. The chapter ends with a vision of a restored Jerusalem where the Lord dwells in Zion, ensuring security and prosperity for his people. Overall, Joel chapter 3 emphasizes God's justice, the fulfillment of prophecy, and the restoration of his people. Why is this so important? Why is Joel? Why is the day of the Lord? Why is all of this important, especially to God's people? Because we serve a just God. Number one is judgment's coming to this land. Because he's a holy God, he's a righteous God, and sin must be punished. Judgment is coming to the house of God first. It is coming to Israel, and it is coming to the unbelieving world. No one will get away with anything. Not one sin will go unpunished. There will be no evil, no wicked, no sin allowed in heaven. It will not make it there. Be careful. There's a lot of church people who I believe will not make it in. You're going to see on the day the Lord returns for his bride, there's going to be people sitting on the pew. There's going to be preachers in the pulpits holding a microphone. There's going to be all kind of people who thought just because they were a preacher, they were a teacher, they were telling people about God's word, but they're not living it. There's a lot of preachers today that are not living what they're preaching. Oh, Lord, have mercy on each one of us. I cry out, Lord, forgive me. This is a sacred office. Every time I step up here behind this pulpit, Lord, check my life. Is it right? I try my best. I don't always get it right. I don't. That's why I need Jesus. I need him tonight. You need him tonight. We all need Jesus tonight. We all need him. More now than ever before, because it's getting hard and harder and harder. I am sounding an alarm tonight, church. If there's one of you here tonight that you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I beg of you to get in the altars, to repent. Some of you here, you've been where you used to know the Lord, and every time the altars were open, you were before the Lord and you were crying out. It used to prick your heart when a preacher would get up here and would tell you that Jesus is coming, but more and more people are forsaking the altars. They're sitting in their pews. They're holding on as tight as they can and say, well, I'll do it tomorrow. Tomorrow may not come. Tomorrow may not come for you. Today we have to get it right. The reason why, the second reason is that the Holy Spirit, we need the power of the Holy Ghost to be able to stand firm and endure until the end. The third thing is to give us a hope and a future, to provide hope that will triumph, that we will triumph, that our foes will be defeated, and that God's people will be restored to their intended state of glory. One day, we will all be made new in Jesus Christ. I'm excited. I'm grieved. I'm all. I do look forward to the day that I'll see my Savior, Crystal. I look forward that I'll stand before Him face to face. We just sang the song, "Come, Jesus, come." We've been waiting so long. Come, Jesus, come. Are you waiting for Him? I am. What does this world have on you? Our pastor just preached about Lot and his wife. The only one said, remember Lot's wife. And she looked back. Why is that? Why was there only one out of all? Jesus wanted us to remember this world has nothing for us. And as much as you love your loved ones and you want everyone to go, you got to love Jesus more tonight. You got to love Jesus more tonight. In conclusion, the day of the Lord, besides being a time of judgment, it will also be a time of salvation, as God will deliver the remnant of Israel, fulfilling His promise that all of Israel will be saved, Romans 11:26, forgiving their sins and restoring His chosen people to the land He promised to Abraham. The final outcome of the day of the Lord will be that the arrogance of man will be brought low and the pride of men humbled. The Lord alone will be exalted in that day. One day, every knee will bow. One day, every tongue will confess. Why not let that be today? Stand to your feet tonight. The word of the Lord tonight is this: the coming of the Lord is near. It's at the door. May your hearts be ready. Prepare today. Delay not. Tonight I'm going to play a song and I'm just going to open up the altars. If you're here tonight and you don't know Jesus as your Savior, if you haven't been serious, you know who you are. If you're not where you need to be tonight, if you're kind of like Pastor said, you're sitting on that fence belongs to the devil. It's been preached here a lot lately. Somebody is not heeding what the Lord is saying. Get off the fence. Either make Lord all of your life, make Him Lord of all of your life, or not Lord at all. Call on the name of the Lord and be saved tonight. These altars are open for you tonight. Come down, rededicate your heart and your life. Everybody that will come, fill up the altars tonight. Let's get before the Lord. Brian, if you'll start that song, it's called One Day.
Question resolved. every anxious thought left behind. No more fear. And when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. One day we will see face to face Jesus. Is there a greater vision of grace? And in a moment we shall be changed on that day. And one day we'll be free, free indeed, Jesus. One day all the struggle will cease, and we will see your glory revealed. Face to face, Jesus, is there a greater vision of grace? And in a moment we shall be changed. In a moment we shall be changed. Yes, in a moment we shall be changed. On that. We all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Oh, we'll sing and shout the victory.
God sent His Son. They called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because
If you don't mind, stretch your hands this way tonight. Hallelujah, Father.
No more in pain.
Thank you.
Hallelujah, church. Hallelujah. Our sister preached to us tonight. Powerful word of God. Do us well. Do us well to take heed. A lot of things I would like to say, but I'm not going to say. The woman of the hour has spoke. And we thank God for the word tonight. Prayer meet tomorrow night, 5:30. Come if you can. Stand with me if you will.